All right, Carol's iPhone. Are you Ms. Vasquez?
Yes, I am.
All right, and Ms. McIntosh, which matter are you here on? Are you here on Branford Townhomes?
Yes, ma'am. I'm the president.
Okay. All right, this is Branford Townhouse Cooperative versus Carol Vasquez. Can I get appearances?
Your Honor, Rick Kaczynski on behalf of the plaintiff, Branford.
Good morning, Your Honor. May it please this honorable court, send us Jabber P84333 on behalf of Carol Vasquez.
Okay, so I've read through all the documentation. Is the probate case still going?
Yes, Your Honor.
Yes.
Okay,
Your Honor,
what's
nothing's
the status?
Been done in almost 2 years on that probate case.
Nothing's been done. That's not true, number one. Number two, if the plaintiff would just sign over the stock certificate.
All right. Listen, let's just focus, okay? I don't want you two, I can tell from your pleadings that you two aren't best friends, all right? But let's just take it down a notch so we can get through this. The case is pending. So the holdup is the signing off of the security certificate?
Can I speak to that, Your Honor?
Give me, yes, but okay. Everybody just, let's not be too hostile. It's
okay.
Too early in the morning.
So, Your Honor, the probate proceedings, the cooperative has no right itself to decide who gets the membership. That's for the probate judge in Wayne County. So it's up to the Vasquez estate to decide on their own the value of the membership is assigned. I assume to Mrs. Vasquez. I don't understand why that hasn't been done. I could see that perhaps they waited during the appeal period, but that's done. So I would suspect that because this was open, the estate was open in October of 21, that we don't. So let's assume that in the probate proceedings that someone else was awarded the membership. The cooperative itself does not have the right to decide in a probate proceedings who's entitled to the value of the membership. We still dispute whether Carol Vasquez should ever become a member of the co-op, but the value of the membership is certainly, I would assume, assigned to her. I don't know why that hasn't been done and why that hasn't been presented to the cooperative. We can't do that. We have no right.
Do we even know what the value of the membership is at this point?
Well, here's the issue for a probate judge to decide. In probate, normally the value of the asset is based on the date of death. And that happened a number of years ago. In fact, that happened when the co-op was not. So the cooperative at one point had restricted bylaws where the membership value was restricted. When Mr. Vasquez died, that was the case. Subsequently, the cooperative modified its bylaws and they went to what we call a market rate co-op. So effectively, a member of the cooperative can list their membership for sale and whatever the market will bear, they're entitled to, subject to the purchaser being approved by the board of directors for membership. That's still—
So Ms. Vasquez, so what you're saying is you want the probate court, and I don't know, this isn't my job, but you want them to tell her at the time of death, it was only worth $7,000 or whatever it might be, even though we're going to now charge the new person who goes to the cooperative $50,000 for it. And the argument is that that's what should be done under the law. Right.
All I'm saying, Judge, is that normally, I've been practicing 46 years and a lot of my practice is probate related. In probate court, when you file an inventory, the court requires you to list the date of death value. Now, the Vasquez estate and the cooperative may have an argument relative to ultimately the value of the membership. If Ms. Vasquez was assigned that membership and decided to vacate and sell her the membership at that point, it would be listed for whatever, $50,000. And then at closing, there could be a dispute as to how those proceeds are divided. That's not the issue here today. The only thing I'm pointing out is that the estate has not taken the affirmative action to close the, to take the steps necessary to assign the value to Ms. Vasquez. We can't do
that. Ms. Jabber, what's going on with that then?
Your Honor, I'm not going to act like I know. Well, I'm not the
probate. Are you doing the, okay.
No, I'm not the probate attorney. I don't specialize in probate. I sent her to a probate attorney, Joe Barone, who's a very reputable probate attorney in Plymouth. Your Honor, he has lots of clients, including clients who are judges. And judges refer him clients as well. Your Honor, he told me, what he told me last was, if the plaintiff would sign over the stock certificate, this would end. So because of the appeal and because of all this going on, he wanted to wait to see after what was going on with today, because if they don't sign over the stock certificate to her, he's going to have to file another civil suit. That's my understanding. He's going to have to file a civil suit. Mr. I didn't interrupt you. Please don't interrupt me. So he's going to have to file a civil suit against the plaintiff to get the stock certificate into her name. And yes, Your Honor, as you pointed out, there's newly updated bylaws that I conveniently wasn't given until the circuit court appeal that says my client is entitled to market rate and they want to give her $7,000 for it. And it's not worth $7,000. One was just sold for like $76,000, roughly, Your Honor. The probate case is still pending. The 2021.
So look, all right. I mean, I needed to know the status to some degree, but now we've got this termination of tenancy on this case, right?
Right.
And on it, there's an allegation. I mean, it's a pretty serious allegation that Ms. Vasquez violated the bylaws. You know, and that she violated the bylaws by firing a gun in the complex. Yes, ma'am?
Your Honor, first of all, this is not a landlord-tenant case. This is not a landlord-tenant case. The Court of Appeals has stated in a published case that this is the Landlord-Tenant Relations Act does not apply to cooperatives because it's not a landlord-tenant relationship. Number one. Number two, Your Honor.
On the appeal for this case is the published decision?
There's published decision that said, not for this case, but in general, there's a published decision. I can tell you its name that we talked about at the first in the first district court case, Pinocchi versus Colonial Cooperatives. I can give you the site if you'd like, Your Honor.
All right, I'm ready.
Okay, the site is 140mich.app.740,745-48. In parentheses, Michigan Court of Appeals, 1985, Pinocchi versus Colonial Cooperative.
Your Honor, can I comment on that?
I'm not done. Also, right. Your Honor, the plaintiff filed a circuit court appeal, and like I said, conveniently didn't give me the updated bylaws until the circuit court appeal, even though I requested them twice at the district court level. Then he filed an application. They filed an application with the Court of Appeals and it was denied within a week. Within a week, they had my client serve for this case, Your Honor, for allegations that happened in October. And those are just allegations, Your Honor. Nothing has happened. All of them are just allegations. They're nothing but allegations from a plaintiff.
Right. Party. Right. But listen, here's my thought. I don't disagree with you that they are looking for a way to get Ms. Vasquez out. I don't disagree with you on that. But it sounds to me, and I understand these are just allegations, but it sounds to me like she's working pretty hard to give them something. I mean, if she is in fact firing a weapon, I mean, what set of bylaws were provided to me? Are these the new ones or the old ones? Right?
Your Honor?
Yes, sir.
On the case cited by counsel, she's not correct. That case stood for cooperatives that the Security Deposit Act did not apply. And we, Your Honor, I'm in your court in front of your judges, generally Judge Slavin, for 25 years or 30 years arguing landlord-tenant cases relative to co-ops. The law is clear. The Summary Proceedings Act governs cooperatives. That's why we're here. And we would not be here, Your Honor. Let's assume that the Court of Appeals, and she keeps referring to that, where it has nothing to do with this case, that we would not be here today unless Ms. Vasquez's conduct caused us to be here. So my board president's here because she wants to potentially voice her concern as a board of directors that we have an individual residing in one of the townhomes, that the police, I have three police reports, I have videos, which will all, if we have to try the case, which will all be presented to a jury or to yourself, which will prove that Ms. Vasquez is a dangerous person living in the co-op.
Ms. Jabber, have you seen the video?
Yes, Your Honor. The police have seen the video as well. And okay. the police have chosen not to charge her because the video is...
Okay. I mean, look. I'm looking at the bylaws. Any member of the member's household or a guest or another person under the member's control shall not engage in acts of violence or threats of violence, including but not limited to the unlawful discharge of firearms on or near project premises. And then it goes on to say that a violation of that provision is a material violation and cause for termination of tenancy. And then it goes on to say, unless otherwise provided by law, proof of violation shall not require criminal conviction, but shall be by a preponderance of the evidence. And if I don't know if this is the new one or the old one, but this was signed by Ms. Vasquez. I mean, it's signed by two people.
Your Honor, the preponderance of the evidence who's going to decide the preponderance of the evidence? The plaintiff?
A jury?
Your Honor, the plaintiff? Yeah, a jury. Yeah, a jury. Fine. That's
right.
Fine.
All right. Slow down. So, look. All right. So, did someone pay for the jury?
I'm sorry, Your Honor.
I didn't file anything, Your Honor.
All right. So, there's been no jury demand or has.
I think Ms. Vasquez, counsel did file. I did in her pleading. She filed for a jury.
I filed the jury demand, Your Honor. I can pay for that today. Your Honor, these are allegations made by the plaintiff. The video is like basically black and white. They're allegations by a party that wants to get her out, Your Honor.
I know, but like that's not ultimately, Ms. Jabber. I do think that they're entitled to process on that. Yeah. And it doesn't matter if I, you know, I'm just looking at the allegation. I respect this as an allegation. I'm not presuming that she did this. I'm not, but I'm saying under the bylaws that are signed by the parties, this is in there. Like it's black and white. So we have to, I mean, we're going to proceed to a trial on it.
Your Honor, first of all, yes, like you said, they are allegations. Second of all, I'd like to see my client's signature because they have not given my client the second set of bylaws. So how did she sign them?
She didn't sign the bylaws.
How did she give them? How did
she get up? Is this 2014?
So then that's the old set of bylaws.
Your Honor, I believe that's the occupancy agreement. I don't know what you're looking at, Your Honor. The members don't sign the bylaws. They were approved.
Vote of the membership. Occupancy agreement. I'm sorry. It's lengthy. So I assume that's what it was, but it's an occupancy agreement. But listen, I understand what the issues are. Does everybody have everything they need? Do we have any reason to do any sort of discovery period or is anything like that needed?
Your Honor, I would think that perhaps a short period of discovery because I've got most of the Taylor police force to talk to because they've been out there three different times. I got three different police reports. So I got to figure out who's going to testify at the trial. There's a gentleman involved in the case. I think he's Ms. Vasquez's boyfriend. We may want to take.
Are we talking about depositions or interviews?
Well, I want to interview the police, but there's a gentleman involved in these, seems to be in all these police reports that we probably want to take his deposition. And I would take Ms. Vasquez's deposition, but I assume she would take the Fifth Amendment on all my questions.
Your Honor, I would definitely, we definitely need a discovery process, and I'd like everything to go through the court, Your Honor. Every up the bylaws, all that, I need it to go through the court. Whatever copy the court gets, I'd like to have, because I don't trust that I'm going to get a real copy of everything.
Your Honor, I'm tired of her disparaging, you know, it's
I just wish you both would, like, listen. Everybody has got to calm down. I want you guys to advocate. I want you to do your jobs. But, like, take it, let's take it down a notch.
If counsel wants discovery, she just has to ask me and tell me what she wants. And I'll
I've asked you. I asked you for the pleadings for this case for almost a month, and you didn't provide.
Why would she not serve this?
Yeah.
Your Honor, okay, let me speak to that. So the original case ended, and 21 days after that case ended, it's over. So we started the new case, and for all I know, Ms. Vasquez would hire other counsel or not have counsel. The court served Ms. Vasquez. I assume that Ms. Vasquez would give all the pleadings to her legal counsel. At some point, the counsel did ask for the pleadings. I was out of the office. My staff forwarded what we had. And for whatever reason, the occupancy agreement wasn't sent to her. That was not done intentionally. And if she wants to amend her answer, I have no problem with that. But it wasn't done intentionally.
No,
and,
Your Honor.
The court, on landlord-tenant cases, the court serves. We don't. I wouldn't serve somebody who I don't know is actually going to represent somebody.
Your Honor, all first of all,
I have no reason to. I have no. She was not party to that case. It's a new case. She was party to the old case.
I have proof.
All right. Well, I don't want here. Listen, going forward, you two have got to work together to some degree. I mean, you have to, because I am not a mediator that's going to sit here and go back and forth with, did you give her this? Does she have this? Does he have that? Like, I'm not getting the court involved in that. If you make discovery requests and you want to file a copy of that with the court, we'll have it. But I'm not going to look, I'm not supposed to look at all that stuff unless it's in front of me, and I don't want it in the court file. So I'm not going to order that everything come through the court, because we don't have storage for a box for this case so that we can make sure you two are complying with the court's order. You're going to comply with the court's order. It's that easy. So let's look. I think, is 60 days appropriate?
Sure, Your Honor.
I mean, it seems like a reasonable amount of time for discovery. I'm going to give you a date. Hold on, I got to get a calendar because mine doesn't go out that far.
Will that be another pretrial or a trial date?
I'm going to set a scheduling order for you. So I'm thinking today's the 20th, 1, 2, 3, 4, 6. So we'll come back on September 20th, or well, discovery ends on 9/21.
I need to say something.
Okay, Carol.
Ms. Vasquez, just let you talk to your attorney, okay?
Okay.
Hold on one second.
You have no civil docket view.
I was going to say, they won't work. I'll be in the hospital.
On 9/20. You don't have to come back to court on that day. This is when discovery ends. This is a lawyer day. Okay. So that's the last day you guys can switch documents. That's when discovery should be completed by. All right. Now, discovery, your court rules mandate what you can do. We're not going to do more than two depositions on this case, right? Or do you just not know right now?
Say that again, Your Honor.
How many depositions do you, I know you think one.
I probably just one or two at the most.
All right. Ms. Jabber, do you agree with that number?
Honestly, at this point, Your Honor, I don't know. I don't think it's unfair to say at least one.
I just don't want this to end up being $30,000 worth of discovery. It shouldn't be.
It shouldn't.
All right.
It's a trial by endurance, and that's what the plaintiff is trying to do. It's a trial by endurance, Your Honor.
Come on. Come on. Let's. All I care about is that you guys are not spending $20,000 on this, and I'm going to limit it. And if someone thinks someone's abusing discovery, file the appropriate motion. Okay. Witness lists are due 9/28. Any dispositive motions are to be filed by 9/28. Answers to dispositive motions are to be filed by 10/12. Any adjournments, agreements, stipulations must be done by tendering a signed stipulation and proposed order. We are going to come back to court 9/28, so it'll be 1, 2, 3, 4. We're going to come back to court on 10/26/23. That's to hear dispositive motions. That's to handle any preliminary matters. And on that date, we'll be setting our trial date. And our trial date will occur before the end of the year.
One other item, Your Honor, because we started the termination action, the cooperative wasn't accepting carrying charges or rent from the member. Will defendant stipulate that we can agree that she continues to pay her carrying charge? Or do I, otherwise we do a rent escrow and she could pay it into the court.
She's been escrowing into my escrow account, Your Honor.
Well, so she's got the money. You've not collected it. We're doing the same thing we did when I saw you last year. You can't charge her a bunch of late fees because you won't take her check.
We don't charge late fees, Your Honor.
Okay.
Under those circumstances.
I just remember last year the number was, I reread the transcript, and there was a dispute about how much was owed.
But so, if we start a termination action, we, you know, under the case actually that was cited, we can't take rent. Otherwise, it reestablishes the lease that month. So we don't.
We did an exception to that last time we were here. We did an exception and we said, I'm going to allow her to pay rent because this case is going to be pending for months.
Well, there is a provision under landlord tenant law for the court to order a rent escrow where the defendant pays the rent into the court.
I'm fine with that. All right, I'm ordering rent escrow.
So that would basically start in August because we're almost through July.
You're out of order. All right. What do you want us to do with the back rent? We don't mind giving it up.
If you want to pay that into the court, that's fine. Or if the judge allows her to pay it to the co-op, that's fine too. It is a nonprofit, so it doesn't have, there's no landlord making any money here. So it's a nonprofit.
All right, well, Ms. Jabber, do you have any problem with just paying the back rent to the cooperative?
No.
All right, so the back rent will go to you starting August 1st. It goes into the escrow account.
Thank you, Judge.
All right, so we're all set. We'll make sure that both of you get a copy of this order, the scheduling order, so you both have it for your records, okay?
Thank you, Judge.
All right, we're all set. Thank you.
Thank you, Judge.
Thank you. Yep.
Can I leave?
Yes, ma'am. You're all set. Thank you.
All right. Thank you. Have a good day.
You too.